Hey everybody, Brion McClanahan here. The woke madness in history education is off the rails. Well, how do we change it? McClanahanacademy.com. And because you listen to this podcast, if you use the coupon code PODCAST at checkout, you get 25% off every day, all day, 365 days a year on every class at McClanahanacademy.com. So go to McClanahanacademy.com, use coupon code PODCAST at checkout, and get a real history education at 25% off. If you like this podcast and you want it without advertisements, head over to patreon.com and become a member of the Brion McClanahan Show. For $10 a month, you get all the podcasts ad-free, including video, and you also get a special Q&A podcast. I'm only going to answer your questions, your listener-generated episodes, through those Q&As. So, head over to patreon.com. Get this podcast ad-free, no ads, not even things like this, and you really do help support the Brion McClanahan Show with really cool stuff on the back end. Mark Levin has a message to America, and it's based on a really stupid understanding of the past. I'll talk about that on this episode of the Brion McClanahan Show.
It's time to think locally and act locally. Welcome to the Brion McClanahan Show.
Welcome back to the Brion McClanahan Show. Glad to be back on the program. Very glad to be here. Always. Well, I've talked about Mark Levin on this show many times. I've talked about the very bad history he simply espouses, which is R good, D bad, based on his understanding of the past. But I want to get into this a little more today, and I want to talk about why it's so important. Now, a couple of weeks ago, I put a post out on X, Twitter, that said we need to stop this nonsense as conservatives, that, you know, Democrats are the party of racism and slavery, while Republicans are the party of freedom and equality. It's not historically accurate, and it's not going to move the needle. What these people think, this is where this becomes problematic. What these people believe, they think, is that somehow some voter who would vote Democrat is not going to pull the lever or punch the card or bubble in the dot, or some dead voter is not going to vote because they think, oh my gosh, if I vote for the Democrats, I'm voting for the party of racism and slavery. And if I vote for the Republicans, I'm voting for the party of freedom and equality. They're not going to do that. The voter that's going to vote Democrat isn't going to think about what the Democratic Party was in 1850 or 1860 or 1870. They don't care. They're not going to vote for the Republican Party because what the Republican Party was in 1850 or 1860 or 1870. Of course, 1854 when it's founded, but they're not going to do that either. They're not going to do any of those things. They're going to bubble in or punch or pull a lever or whatever they're going to do now, based on what they think that party is going to do for them today. Do they think that party, the Democrat Party, is going to have the most candy in the candy bowl? Are they going to give it to them? Do they think the Republican Party is going to do X, Y, or Z for them? That's what they're going to pull the lever for. That's how they're going to vote today. What happened 150 years ago, really, in the mind of these voters, and I can guarantee this when they go to the polls, is irrelevant. This is a stupid effort to try to supposedly persuade voters to not vote Democrat and vote Republican. It's idiotic. And it makes you look stupid. And that's the problem. Because some of this history is incorrect. It's not complex. It doesn't show the various shades in these things. And I'll talk about it when I read Mark Levin's Message to America that was promoted by the Blaze Media. So Glenn Beck does so many good things, has done so many good things. He's said a lot of correct things. The problem is he's still in bed with people like Mark Levin and David Barton and some of these morons that are supposedly masquerading as historians. They're really bad at it, and they shouldn't do it, and it makes Glenn look stupid. So, if we're going to be honest, now we could say the modern Republican Party, the current Republican Party, does a better job at, supposedly, at curtailing the surveillance state, the warfare state, these kind of things. Supposedly, we know, as Thomas Massie just went on the floor of Congress as I'm recording, or into a, I'm sorry, committee meeting in Congress, said this is all political theater. We're all going to vote for it. We're all going to get this stuff. We're supposedly against it, but we're going to get it anyways. We know the Republicans don't do a very good job in Washington, D.C. opposing these things, if that's what they're for. We know the Democrats are currently the party of massive immigration, the welfare state, DEI, all the things that, I mean, which is modern day racism, that we know that they're in favor of that. We know that they're in favor of the totalitarian state. So if you make the statement that Republicans are the party of, say, freedom, you could nominally say that. At least the voters tend to be that way, not the party itself. You could say that the Democrats are interested in totalitarianism. You could say that, and I think with a straight face, be honest about it. The voters are generally for that because that's what they want to do to other people. They want to make other people. It's the secular Puritanism of the Democratic Party. I've talked about the political Puritans. I've talked about on this show, right? So you could say those things now, but if you're going to try to connect a history to it, you're going to fail. You're going to fail. In fact, it's really stupid. It makes history into a cartoon, an eighth grade cartoon that doesn't work. We shouldn't do those things. We shouldn't do those things. So let me get into Levin's message to America. It's not long. It's not long. And it has some of the most idiotic statements you'll ever see. So let's start. He says, "Friend, the Democrat Party will stop at nothing to convince the American people that it's Trump and the Republicans who are racist." Well, this is true. They won't stop. They try to convince everybody of that. They do make that a major point. Why? Because it's an emotional argument. There's no substance to it in terms of, I mean, you could find, I'm sure, racists in the Republican Party. They exist. Okay? They exist in the Democratic Party, too. But playing the racism game is an emotional argument. And I've said before, the reason that people vote today is based on emotion. How do they feel? How does this party make them feel? How does this thing make them feel? This is how they vote. And so if you understand that, nothing you can do historically is going to change that. And your understanding, which is distorted of history, in this case, if you're listening to Mark Levin, won't change what they're going to do here. Now, you could say, well, McClanahan, this is going to have an impact because then the argument won't work because they say we're racist. You just say they're racist. Oh, yeah, that works. I'm sure that voter that's going to get the big bowl of candy really cares. As a matter of fact, they probably would say, so what? What are they giving me? Right? What are we getting out of this? But you see, this is where these people feel like they have to somehow react to this. When the charge is going to be made, regardless, it doesn't matter what happened in the past. It doesn't matter if the Republican Party, which they haven't been, has been pure as the driven snow on this issue. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if the Democrats had done every racist thing in America. It doesn't matter because what are they giving people now? You see, people vote for the now. They don't vote for 1860 or 1880 or 1910 or 1940. They don't vote for that. They vote for now. Now, we know that policies can be based on things that, I mean, look, the entire military-industrial complex, the Cold War, all of that still factors into how these dopes in Washington, D.C. vote to spend our money. Or the money they're printing. We know these things happen. But, on the other hand, this isn't going to move the needle in one way or another. They're going to make these accusations because they think it works. And it doesn't matter what happened before. When Americans are walking around thinking Hitler built the Berlin Wall, or some of the other nonsense they believe that they get on social media, it doesn't matter what Mark Levin says. Then he says this, but I think a history lesson is due. Well, if it was a good history lesson, that might be a good thing. I mean, we can talk about history. I'm not going to discount the importance of history. So this sounds a lot like Kamala Harris. and I mean that because this is the kind of stuff she would say. We have the North, which was this country, and the South, which was this country, and they were along this border, and they fought this war. So here is Mark Levin's history lesson. The Civil War was fought between the North and the South, between the Confederacy and the Union. It's one country fighting another country, between the Republican Party and the Democrat Party. The Civil War was fought between the Republican Party and the Democrat Party. Now, this is a strange argument to make for so many reasons. Number one, in the North, you had Democrats that were fighting with the United States against the Confederacy. I mean, U.S. Grant was a Democrat before the war. Right? Edwin Stanton, one of the most awful people. I mean, this guy, in terms of civil liberties, was terrible. Secretary of War, he was a Democrat. He was a Democrat. Andrew Johnson was a Democrat. They weren't Republicans. Now, maybe they became Republicans during the war, or maybe after the war. They were Democrats. I'll never forget reading when I was working on my dissertation on James Byard, and he was writing letters to his son at this time period, right? 1861, 1862. He had some very glowing things to say about Edwin Stanton. He thought that was going to be a good appointment because Stanton was going to do the right thing. Stanton was terrible, but Byard was a Democrat. He thought that the Democrats would be a little easier on civil liberties. He was mistaken. Stanton was power hungry. But there were many Democrats that supported the war. So to say that it was a war between the Republican Party and the Democrat Party is very simplistic. In fact, you know, a fourth grader could come up with something better than this. But this is Kamala Harris writing history. I'm serious. This is the kind of stuff that dope would say. This is why it's so stupid. We shouldn't do this kind of thing. It makes us look stupid. Then he says the Democrat Party was the party of slavery. Well, we had a lot of slave owners that weren't Democrats. In fact, even during the war, there were people that became Republicans, that were Democrats, but became Republicans who were still slave owners. The Blairs, for example. But the largest slave owner in Delaware was a Republican. And here's the thing. So was the member of the House from Delaware, George Fisher. He was a Republican and a slave owner. When Lincoln floated his compensated emancipation plan, he got the idea from Fisher, who brought a man named Burton, that was the slave owner, to Lincoln so they could discuss this. And the idea was, well, this is how much money it's going to cost to compensate me for all of my slaves. He only had about 20, a little over 20, I think, was the largest slave owner in Delaware. But he was a Republican, a Republican. This is where Dinesh D'Souza says, there are no Republicans that own slaves. Of course there were. It's just silly. So here we have this situation. Of course, Lincoln presents this plan. The House rejects it. The Congress rejects it. But Republicans also own slaves. And again, this gets into this very stupid issue of, you know, well, it's the left might as well write this stuff. Well, we just had these evil white guys and the Democrats were the, but see, to the, this is all Democrats. It's not just evil. We have good guys, Republicans, and bad guys, Democrats. You see? So, I mean, this is a ridiculous statement. Now, you could say, if you said the Democratic Party is the party of modern slavery, or if you want to say that we're slaves of the state or whatever you want to do, that's a stronger charge. But who cares? I mean, again, They think this is going to move the needle. Well, I was going to vote for the Democrats, but then I learned that the Democratic Party was, they supported slavery. Then I'm not going to vote for the Democrats. A person that's going to go vote for the Democrats is going to do it anyways, because they want the policies of the Democratic Party espouses today. It doesn't matter what they did in 1860. This is where these people can't get over themselves. Heck, I like the old Republicans. But you know what? That's not the modern Republican Party. But I'm not going to go vote Republican because of what happened in 1801. I'm not going to vote Democrat because of what happened in 1832, right? I'm not going to do that either. What's the policy today? So what's this person want today? This is just stupid nonsense. Then there's this one. Democrat generals formed the Ku Klux Klan following the war. Although the media denies it, the KKK was an appendage of their party. False. Now, were people who were Democrats forming the Klan after the war? Yes. There's actually a book. It's right over my shoulder, on my left shoulder. I don't know if you can see it, but there's a book. Her name is Parsons. She talks about the formation of the early Klan and what it was. It's an academic, a modern academic book. She's certainly not an apologist for the Klan in any way. But what she says is really interesting. She says, you know, part of the Klan was simply a fabrication of the Northern media. And then she does say this thing went away. What people, the Klan that people think about was the second Klan, the 19-teens Klan, the 1920s Klan. And you want to know something? There were a lot of Republicans involved in that. In fact, the governor of Colorado, the governor of Oregon, the governor of Indiana, all Republicans, all Klan members. So if the Klan was simply a Republican, an appendage of the Democratic Party, where'd these Republicans come from? You see, by the time we get to that, by the time we get to the Klan that people recognize, well, it's something entirely different. It's not an outgrowth of the Reconstruction policies and all the disruption to American politics following the war, which there was a lot of things going on there. This is something entirely different. It's the xenophobic, racist, anti-Semitic institution that people know. That's the 19-teens, 1920s Klan. And that's the one that had bipartisan support. So if you say, well, the Democrats, yes, the people that were forming the Klan in the 1860s were Democrats, primarily. You could say some of them were old Whigs. And even when you get to the 19-teens, there were a lot of Democrats, of course, who were in favor of the Klan. This is simply true. It is true. There were also a lot of Republicans, because the Klan had branches all over the United States in places that were strongholds of, say, Republicans. They were there. In fact, the Democrats had a lot of Catholics in their party. Kind of hard to be a Klan member if you're a Catholic. You see? It really doesn't work. So this is the funniest thing about all this stuff, when Mark Levin makes these kind of statements. The Democratic Party later supported segregation. Well, that's true. So did the Republican Party, by the way. And, of course, segregation was started in the North. Jim Crow segregation that people focus on was a Northern institution. In fact, they used the term in Connecticut in the 1830s. I don't think these people were Democrats. You see? Some of them might have been. But 1830s, we're seeing the term Jim Crow used in New England. Now, he doesn't make a distinction here between North and South. He just says Democrats. It's kind of a way to wiggle around this issue. But if you go read C. Van Woodward's The Strange Career of Jim Crow, he points the finger right back at the North for this institution that is American, not just Southern. America had a Democrat administration when Plessy v. Ferguson occurred. America had a Democrat administration, and the federal Supreme Court ruled that separate but equal was equal. Now, wait a second here. America had a Democrat administration. So somehow, the President of the United States was involved in the Plessy v. Ferguson decision. Well, that's not true. And then when you look at the composition of the Supreme Court, when that decision was issued, it was still dominated by Republicans. Because Republicans had appointed most of the members of the Supreme Court, beginning with Lincoln, into the late 19th century. In fact, there was only one Democratic president during that time. That was Grover Cleveland. And Cleveland, I can't remember, had just a couple of appointments. I mean, it was nominal. His impact on the court was nominal at this point. And so we had a Republican-dominated Supreme Court that made this decision. Not a Democrat-dominated Supreme Court, but a Republican-dominated Supreme Court. So his history lesson falls apart right there. The Democrats' great hero, Franklin Roosevelt, refused to sign a bill that would have outlawed lynching. Why? Because he didn't want to lose Democratic votes in the South. Well, there were also lynchings in the North. In fact, some of the most famous, or infamous, I should say, were in the North, places like Nebraska and Indiana. Again, dominated by Republicans. Levin ignores this stuff because it doesn't fit his silly fourth grade narrative of American history. Democrats bad, Republicans good. Woodrow Wilson, another horrendous segregationist and racist, resegregated the military and the civil service after Taft and Roosevelt had desegregated them. Well, that's true. Wilson did do that. He also required that people provide a photograph with their applications for jobs so that his cabinet could avoid hiring black people. This is the history of the Democratic Party or Democrat Party on the issue of racism. Okay. I mean, this did happen during the Wilson administration, by the way. I mean, there's no denying these things happen. Yeah. And the Republican Party was trying to integrate and these kind of things. That was the charge. Republican Party is more interested in integration. Now, it's also, I mean, so is he going to ignore? If you want to say that, well, the Republicans were just interested in this, and of course, Levin would say Confederacy bad, right? Confederacy is racism and slavery. It's Roosevelt that issued the executive order that returned Confederate flags to the South. It's Taft who was there when the cornerstone was laid at the Arlington Confederate Monument and making a great speech. It's Taft who called the Filipino people his little brown brothers, who had this white man's burden mentality with American imperialism. It's Taft who went before a historically black college and university, HBCU, and made some statements that we would consider in 2024 to be virulently racist. That's Taft. So these people held racial views of the day without any question. They did. They held the same kind of racial views. They just didn't do the policy that would go with it. So to say that these people were not racist, I mean, it's kind of silly. Again, you're cherry picking, you're whitewashing some things to make a point of R good, D bad, which is, I mean, it's simplistic and silly. Even though the party now waves the banner of inclusivity and acceptance for all, it is still the party of racism. At its core, nothing has changed. It's why the Democrat Party is also the pro-Hamas party. The party still waves that banner, right? See, they have taken their belief system behind civil liberties and civil rights, the idea that each of us should be treated as an individual human being, and transformed it to fit their Marxist agenda. They've replaced equality with equity, and if you don't get on board, you are the racist. I mean, again, what he just says there is true. And what they're doing, what the left is doing, this is not necessarily party, because people on the right do this stuff too. But it's what the modern progressive notion wants to do. That's the issue. They trash Trump, MAGA, and Republicans because they stand in the way of their party's end goal, to fundamentally transform America. Anyone who values the Constitution, capitalism, conservatism, and individualism is a barrier that must be overcome. And so they call these institutions and beliefs, as well as the people who support them, racist. And in doing so, the party proves once again that it is actually the racist party. Now, that last paragraph is true. This is what the Democrats do. That's their modern push. But again, you could make this argument and leave out the bad history. Because the next statement is just so stupid, it's not even funny. And let's be clear. The Republican Party was founded in the 1850s to fight racism. To fight racism. Now, the only good book that Eric Foner ever wrote was entitled Free Soil, Free Labor, Free Men. And in that book, he conclusively shows that the Republican Party was not interested in an anti-racist agenda. In fact, we can go back and find all of these Republicans that said some pretty darn racist things. That the Republican Party's end goal of keeping blacks out of the West was actually for, dun-dun-dun, racism. You see, it wasn't founded to combat racism. Now, you could say, he says this, it was an abolitionist party, false, built to combat Democrats on that specific issue. False. That whole statement is false. It wasn't an abolitionist party. In fact, you can find statement after statement after statement, even from the great saint himself, Abraham Lincoln, that he wasn't interested in abolishing slavery where it already existed. In fact, he proposed an amendment in 1862 that would have allowed slavery to exist until 1900. Gradual emancipation, as he started talking about the Emancipation Proclamation. But at the beginning of the war, he said, I'm not going to touch slavery where it exists. He supported the Corwin Amendment, which would have kept slavery permanent in the South. Is that a man that's an abolitionist? Absolutely not. Republicans simply wanted to keep slavery bottled up in the South. And you could say, well, McClanahan, eventually they thought it would go away. Well, possibly. It could have existed. I mean, we don't know. They weren't really concerned about that. As long as it didn't go into the Western territories, as long as Southerners didn't move into the Western territories with their slaves, they were fine with it, whatever it existed previously. And it wasn't about they felt bad for black people. They wanted to do this for white people. And they made this clear. This is why. Because they didn't want competition from black people in the Western territories. They wanted this for free white men. It's what Eric Foner in Free Soil, Free Labor, Free Men talks about. You can get Leon Litvak, his book, North of Slavery. It's very good. The Frontier Against Slavery is another good one. I mean, this stuff is out there, right? It's not like this is something that just people have discovered. It's all there. These books have been there for 50 and 60 years. And somehow Mark Levin ignores them. Now, I mean, that's the sad thing about it. Mark Levin is a very bad historian. And he concludes, he says, and although it looks different, Republicans are still fighting Democrats on the issue of racism today. But if you're going to make a stupid historical statement, you're going to lose all credibility. And he shouldn't do this stuff. It's not going to move the needle because nobody's going to pull a lever for a Republican that was going to vote Democrat because of what happened in the 1850s. You can make the statement about what the Democratic Party is now. You can make a statement about what the Republican Party is now. It doesn't matter. You can make those statements all day. And hey, okay, we could debate whether, you know, this is 100% true or not. Are the Republicans really against these things or for these things? Are the Democrats really against these things or for these things? We could have that conversation. That's a good conversation to have. But to make this about the history, which is, I mean, bad history, is stupid. It's not going to move the needle. At all. At all. And we should stop doing it. That's my point. Stop doing these things that won't matter, and particularly when you make statements that simply are not true. Because it makes you look like a very bad historian, which Levin actually is in many ways. All right. See you next time with the Brion McClanahan Show. See you then.